And we'll see what happens. Okay, so lock flow, obviously, right? It's a dynamic mode. Lock flow is a dynamic mode of training locks, right? It's like randori or rolling in jiu-jitsu. That's the only thing, right? Exactly. Instead of standing there and Tim grabs me and I do some static mode lock here while I have to deal with the real threat, what we do is we actively deal with the lock itself as a response to the real threat. If I come in here and do some variation of an S-lock, they may or may not work. But in the meantime, Steve, Tim, anybody on the planet that knows anybody about fighting, anything about fighting at all, you, anybody that's had any boxing, any wrestling, anybody who does is anything except a deer in the headlights is going to move.
Absolutely.
Right? So when he grabs me, what I have to plan for is him actually fighting me. Right? Now, a lot of people will argue that you can set these locks and do damage, and maybe you can, maybe you can't. The problem is, there's only one way to find out, and that's to see if you get hit.
Right.
So what we do in lock flow is we take that out of the equation while we're doing the locking. Right? There are three rules to locking. Never chase a lock, never force a lock, and always distract. Always distract. Right. So always strike to distract, however you want to say it. The point is, if I go for a lock here, maybe I'm doing a wrist lock here, and I go to start doing this wrist lock, and Tim pulls his hand away. If he pulls his hand away, and I keep trying to get the lock back, that's actively chasing it, right?
And forcing, right.
If he's locking his arm out and giving me a hard time, or you're a big, strong guy, and you're like, I don't think so, and you kind of lock your arm out, and I'm trying to shove that lock in there, I'm forcing it, right?
And you're committing both your hands.
I'm really committing myself to one thought, one action. I'm locking my brain into one mode of reaction instead of acting. Action beats reaction within arm's reach. So I don't want to lock my brain into thinking these ways, right? Never chase, never force. Always distract, though. That's the key. If all I do when Tim grabs me here is get ready to prepare and hit him, 9 times out of 10, that distraction is enough to catch him off guard so that I can start moving, right? You grab me cross arm, it doesn't matter. You're getting ready to hit me with that hand, right? As soon as I do that, see how your body reacts to that.
Even now, though it doesn't hurt me, it makes me stop.
Right. Now this barrier is created. Now you can try to continue hitting me, but now, now the lock itself passes the motion, right? It's lock flow, it's not a lock. In lock flow, the transition between the locks is usually far more important than the locks themselves. That's what most people don't get. They're like, which lock do I do? The first one, the second one, inside, outside, armbar, whatever.
Sure,
doesn't matter. What happens is what you want to do is flow. People often translate judo, for instance, as the gentle way. That shows a real ignorance of translation technology, right?
Judo throws are not gentle.
They're not gentle. Jew and judo and jiu-jitsu does not translate properly to gentle. It translates to yielding or to give way. Now, when you do that, sometimes you can yield and give way gently, but that does not mean that Jew means gentle. Judo is not the gentle way, it's the yielding way. Jiu-jitsu is yielding techniques or yielding methods. Instead of forcing it, you bend like a reed in the wind. That's the principle of Jiu, right? So when you grab me to do a lock, I could try all kinds of crazy stuff here, but the moment I start trying to force this lock, not only am I putting myself in danger for you to actually do something instead of being static, but even if you don't and I catch you off guard, because I'm fixated here, your buddy right here starts blitzing me in the head. Because I'm overly conscious of what I'm doing instead of relaxing and being in the moment. Right? In the Japanese, they kind of call this no mind. Right? You just let go and you are. You don't want to fixate. Same thing when you're rolling, doing judo. You just kind of feel what's there and you take it.
I know a common practice, Boggy did it. Johans did it, Ezra does it, is blindfolds.
Mm-hmm. And we have blindfolds right here.
Yeah, you feel what's going on because you can't really, when we're hooked up, you don't really see the person.
We're actually going to do that here shortly. We actually have blindfolds and we do that very drill. Right? But we're going to start talking about lock flow and how we apply locking right? So what I'm gonna do is show you the first three rudimentary locks and show you how to transition. Then you're gonna do it amongst yourselves a little bit. So we'll talk about it. So I'll take, we'll let Tim do it, right? So the first rule of locking is what?
Distract.
You can always say the first rule is actually distract. Because if you forget everything at all, distracting usually helps.
Right.
Right? So if you forget anything, the first rule is distract. Right? That makes me active instead of passive. Action beats reaction within arm's reach, 9 times out of 10. So if I just sit here and wait for him to move, I'm reacting and he's acting. So instead, as soon as he touches me, my boom, I act. I become functional instead of static, right? So what I'm gonna do, first thing, we're gonna do a simple outside wrist lock. For those playing the home game, right? It's simply here, some variation thereof. There's a dozen ways to do it. The lock is not as important as the transition itself. You know, my wrist is here, I fold it, right? I get his weight off the center line, I pivot, he goes down, right? Any variation of that is an outside, what we call an outside wrist lock. It's an outside wrist lock because I'm turning his body in a circle to the outside. So when he grabs me here though, instead of going, got it, I don't do that because what? I'm right here, right on the tracks, right in the middle of the line of fire. So the moment I start doing something here, I'm actively taking the strike. Now a lot of people like to say, well, you're doing it wrong. I'm gonna step back.
That's even worse.
That's actually worse.
Yeah.
Because forward pressure. I can go backwards a lot less efficiently and effectively than he can go forward. So if I come here and start to step back, he loads in, he's gonna destroy me. Now, a lot of people don't like this because it's not classical jiu-jitsu. But our jiu-jitsu primarily comes from Hawaii, from Danzenru, which is a newer style of jiu-jitsu designed for street fighting, because that's the Jiu in Kajukenbo.
It's not like battlefield jiu-jitsu.
Right, it's not this old stuff. Jiu-jitsu. It's not the old stuff, it's the new stuff. The new hotness instead of the old busted, right?
Yeah.
So, first thing, if he touches me, what do I say?
I don't fight.
It doesn't matter if you don't or you do. But I want to say this way actively because it consciously makes me think in terms of putting my hands up in a defensive posture. Right? And if anybody's watching, if there's any police, anybody with a camera phone,
they said he didn't want to fight.
They said it. Didn't say I couldn't, didn't say I wouldn't, didn't say I can't. Just don't want to. And that's true. I rarely, if ever, want to fight. I don't want to fight. Now, what I'm gonna do is zone. If you look at the floor here, we call this a scada. It's a big asterisk on the floor. What I'm gonna do is zone. Zoning means I'm gonna go to the outside at a 45 degree angle. In short, my footwork is here. Right? So if I do nothing else and he goes to hit me in the face,
you're off the fire.
I should be clear. Now, we're not gonna play that simply, right? But that's it. He throws the punch, I'm here. Right? He can open his hand, palm me in the head. Right? He may clip me, go ahead. Right? But as long as he's trying to hit me and I'm moving, that's what? A glancing blow. Force generation is based on the time and target and the range of motion. So if I'm coming in here, his force generation's out here. When I hit here, now he's gonna knock me loose, right? But if I come in here and he clips me, that's a glancing blow with a fraction of the power that he would have at a full impact.
They say a lot of times boxers do. Blows that will break their, cause the boxer's fracture here would be a glancing blow. It's just that last knuckle hits and slips off.
Exactly. So that's why we're moving exactly the way we do. Now notice though, I said what? I don't want to fight. So now when I move, he's like, this is bullshit. He goes to hit me, whoa, my hand's up. Right? This creates a barrier, a line defense here. But it's passive if I just step with my hand up. And this is active, it's dynamic. So when he goes there, I don't want to fight. And I hit him. I just palm him in the head. Now notice, he can recover his hand here. But what he's thinking about when I move here is this, and the fact that I hit him in the head. So now I do the wrist lock. My hand comes up towards center line. Take the wrist. Notice my foot. I'm forward on the zone. I'm simply going to slowly keep this close to my body, do any variation of the wrist lock your way, and step backwards.
Step backwards and
pivot exactly where I came from. If I'm here, or if I barn door up, all I'm going to do is come back around. If I'm neutral, then I come up, then all the way back at a 45. If you're here, I step and slide forward and pivot out. Point is, I'm creating this line. If you look at Giada, I'm on the straight line for the outside 45. The male triangle, right? Male, female. Brother Adam? Right, so when you grab me, I don't want to fight. Boom. Notice his body, his weight and everything goes back onto that rear line. That's all I did is palm him in the head, but his weight's already decentralized. So if his weight's going backward, what does he natively want his weight to go? Or back forward, which is exactly what happens. I go here, boom, he goes forward, right into the throw, right?
Yep.
And I can take whatever variation of the locks I need to from here. Right? So it's
kind of like a wrestling principle when you're pummeled up. If you want to throw him this way, you're going to pull him this way.
Exactly
first.
Right. If I want you to go forward, I send you backwards. Right. If I want you to go left, I pull you right.
Right, because I'm naturally.
You're naturally going to augment it. In the Japanese force. Systems, they like to call this kazushi.
Kazushi. Right? That's. I was trying to think of that earlier.
In Japanese systems, at judo especially, they like to talk about kazushi. The problem with some of it is it's very dynamic. The way they're doing the randori, that they're trying to force kazushi. Since we're striking, my kazushi's very easy.
Yeah.
I don't have to do anything fancy. Matt's big enough that if he doesn't want me to fall down or knock him down, he ain't gonna do it, right? He knows enough jujitsu, he's gonna fight this. But when I go here, he's going down, right?
I'm in a tight spot.
But it's about the active versus the passive techniques, right? Tony grabs me for the first wrist lock. I don't want to fight. Now Tony's going to respect me. So what he's going to do is palm me in the head. You should do it hard enough, trembling shock here, right? If he hits me, it should get my attention. Because I need to know if I failed, if I screwed up.
Tony's going to have his hand up higher.
So Tony's ready to hit me. Now I don't want to fight. He goes. Boom, right there. That's all I gotta do. Now this could be a spear finger, could be a punch, eye jab, backhand, shot to the groin, gut, anything. Doesn't matter. Right here, I don't wanna fight. Now, see his balance?
Uh-huh.
I roll it, keep it close to my chest, I'm back. Now, usually, when I go to the ground, yeah. Can I go to a handcuffing position? Yeah. Can I take Brazilian stuff? Yeah. Doesn't matter what you do. Right, but that's the principle behind lock flow to flow. This is just the first lock in a series.
And the wrist is the first.
Outside wrist lock. The first lock in this series. Yeah. We'll practice it from a collar grab. Mm-hmm. It's an easy way to line it, right? I don't want to fight. I can knock that down, see?
Yeah.
What is that called when I strike the line to open the elbow?
Dumog.
Right? It's a limb destruction. I don't want to fight. He goes, hit me, bang. Boom. See how it's folded? Look at it. You okay, Tons?
Oh, yeah.
Look at his body mechanics. Now when I come back, he's done, right? I'm holding him up, basically.
Yeah.
Yep.
So I don't try to overpower a strong guy here. He grabs me. Right? He's done.
Yeah. I think I need to see it again.
Resisting.
You okay,
Matt? Yeah, I'm good.
Right? I don't fight this. Matt, if Matt doesn't want me to do this wrist lock, he locks his arm up here. Watch.
Yeah.
You okay, buddy?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Just the...
That one felt like it flicked.
It flicked a little bit. It's...
Give it a second, see if your stomach hurts.
I mean, just the general area, he could have tapped me on the inside of my thigh, and it was close enough to where
exactly.
I had to say.
If I just go here, if you lock your arm out, don't let me move it, right? Watch. That's all it takes.
Don't think about your arm.
When you don't know it's coming and something flies in that general vicinity, your natural reaction is
here. That's what it is. Never chase, never force, always distract. And distracting is so important, you could probably put it first.
Because if you distract,
it's so important,
you don't have to chase it anymore.
Right.
Shouldn't be anything to chase.
Always distract. There's few things more distracting than getting punched in the dick or the face.
I mean, in the beeper.
Yeah, exactly. There you go.
In the trouble stick.
Yeah. Right? So you guys understand it? Mm-hmm. You okay?
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. So hitting to the groin is legal in Kajukenbo and encouraged in practice. People don't understand that this is a contact-oriented self-defense system. Right. You don't try to hurt your opponents, I mean your training partners, but you do soften them up a little bit. Right? So remember, the filming is here.
I guess that's where the control comes in.
Absolutely.
It's to be able to inflict pain without injuring.
Right. Some people talk about PPCT, which are pressure point control tactics, right? I inflict enough discomfort
to
get you to respect my authority, right? I don't have to hurt you, but I need to get you distracted, and I need you to start taking me serious. Because this started out poorly for everyone involved. Mm-hmm. Right? So remember, we've got lines here and here. Go ahead, guys. Do the first lock. Tie up, get a partner, pay your respects.
Tony, I'll start.
So, boom. Steps off the line, sets the wrist, steps back. Now, you don't have to drop him right here. That's perfectly fine, Tony. Right? Because this is a lock flow, right? If you drop him every time, the drill gets really slow. We're going to get to the flow here. But we're just doing our first wrist lock so you guys warm up.
So I stayed...
Zone more, like step in more with a strike. Because you're kind of fingertips, go palm.
It's just a very Aikido-ish right.
So you want to immediately, when you immediately,
a minute of touch, before I need to get a grip.
Yeah.
There you go.
I want to be here.
Good. Switch your back. Right back and forth.
Yeah. Feel that you can't recover.
Right. And this hand's probably going to rush to defend this wrist before it tries to.
Just one, right?
Yeah, just do the first one for now.
Better?
Get both hands on.
Yeah, okay.
Hang on.
Go one more.
There.
Yeah.
Okay.
I augmented
that.
Yeah,
fine.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. Time. Relax, guys. Very good.
Yeah. It's
a keto. All this set.
So when you understand this principle, right, you can start worrying about the lock, right? Tony grabs me, and I really want to drop him, right? So what I would do, right, I get the softening up, bang, bang, highline, lowline, distraction. Boy, if you'll start, right? If I really wanted him to go down, there's a dozen ways to do this lock, right? I can set the wrist, compress it. I can go straight down. I can augment my palm, I can augment my fingers, right? It doesn't matter how you do the wrist lock or what variation you happen to enjoy in your system or training methodology. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter because it's very forgiving because the transition, the movement between the techniques, between the locks, the waza, if you will, is more important 99 times out of 100 than the lock itself. When you fixate on the lock, you are no longer flowing. You're forcing and chasing.
It kind of reminds me of
it's all reference points.
The Eddie Bravo concept to where you go from one submission to the next fluently until you catch them.
Right, that's exactly what we're doing.
Yeah. Yeah,
lock flow isn't a race to the finish.
Right.
It's just jogging down the road until somebody falls into a pothole and breaks their ankle.
Right.
It is standing jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
And just like you would do on the ground where you set a trap, whether it's a armbar, Americana,
Kimura, whatever, it doesn't matter.
And you're going for those.
That makes sense.
It's the exact same thing. You just have to know
the way
traps.
Eddie Bravo said, if you go from one to the next fluently, they will eventually fall into one.
So mm-hmm.
When they make a mistake, they'll be falling into a submission, and then it's there.
So all we're doing is giving them a lot of chances to make mistakes, right? But again, the key is, this is lock flow, not wrist lock number one, right? Here we go. Here's the second one, right? So I'm here. Over here, little chunk, right? I don't want to fight. Bang, right? I get the distraction, soften him up. Now I start doing the wrist lock, but I instinctively move. I come back here, right? And I train the moment that maybe the wrist lock isn't working. Maybe he's dropped his base, he's dropped his hips, right? Any variation thereof, right? So it moves. I come here, boom. I immediately distract him again. Notice this hand comes online. So if he throws that one, right, and this hand is active. It's not passive sitting here. It's boom, boom. Now, what I'm going to do, my inside centerline, belly button to belly button, the opposite hand comes in and checks the pulse. Right? Now, it's not technically checking the pulse, but that's what we call it for practice. My thumb comes on the top. Now, I'm going to replace my feet, replacement step.
It's my left foot. Few times where your thumb actually does grab.
Right. One of the few times we literally grab.
Yeah.
I'm going to take my front foot, make it the back one, and pull him and uppercut. Make sure you close your mouth here so you don't take a shot. Right, I pull him into a floating armbar. Now, when you look at this, this uppercut is here. Notice my palm is matching his. Not around his wrist or around his fingers. I'm palm to palm here with this locking position. So when I turn this, see his elbow?
Yes.
That's a control point, Matthew. Right, when I'm here, I'm not here on his wrist because Matt's strong enough, that's going to pivot. Yeah. Right, he's too big. Mm-hmm. But if I go here, right, I can lock that.
Catches my hand.
I hook it. Mm-hmm. It's pinned on my palm to his.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so he can turn it. Now, again, it's not impossible. If I keep forcing this to keep it down, then I'm violating lock.
And all else being equal.
All else being equal, yeah. Size does matter. This is a transition. I come here, then I uppercut, bang. Now, what I do is I come here, do the uppercut, go to the Golgi tendon right behind the elbow, and set that. Notice how he's on his toes? You respect me?
Absolutely.
Right? Right, that's the key. If he moves, his weight moves, right?
Choices are limited.
Yeah. He grabs me, I don't want to fight. Bang, boom, bang. Lock one, step it out, boom. I immediately see his balance.
Correct.
Before he can get his balance, hit again, uppercut. See him come up on his toes?
Mm-hmm. Right, doesn't take much.
Do you hear that's... It's
a, you're doing it more by pushing that hand down than
yeah.
raising this
yeah.
hand.
If I go try to lift this hand up too high, he's too tall. I keep this locked down.
Yeah, because if this comes up too high...
Yeah, you're going to fold me.
Yeah.
Right, my arm, I'm hyperextending his elbow at my hip. Now people like, can I lock his head here and break this? Yeah. Can I throw knee? Yeah. Can I spike? Yeah. I mean, you can do a dozen things here. It doesn't matter.
Again,
transition.
It's also just
transition.
Yeah.
Exactly.
This is one path you can take.
This is just a training mode. It's just a way to train, right? I don't want to fight. Bang, boom, bang. Rock one, rock two. Mm-hmm. Hyperextend. See his toes? Mm-hmm. That means I got the lock and he respects my authority.
Does he?
Okay. Uh-huh. Everybody know it?
Yep.
Partner up and go. Lock one to the palm up reverse arm bar. Reverse wrist lock, outside wrist lock to the palm up arm bar.
I don't want
to
fight.
Liar. Good. See, now you can just inverse it. Boom. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Go slow with that bounce because you will hyperextend.
Yeah.
So now we're starting to flow. We're not just going to one lock.
Let's see if I can.
I can go this way. Just go slower, because that back wrist got torn during knife fights last month.
Did it?
Yeah. It did.
What happened?
You got from here. Somebody struck me in the hand, and I didn't know until I woke up the next day.
From here.
Got one to fight.
Yeah, you're right.
Why you're focused on that?
Yes. Right.
So it's not.
Go slow. Good. Golgi. Good. Everybody knows where the Golgi tendon is, right? So about where you think, it's that soft part behind where you think your funny bone is.
In between the tricep and the elbow.
Yep.
Oh, no.
That's where we're hyperextending.
Parker, I don't want to fight.
Watch the language, guys. You're on tape.
Sorry.
Oh, shit. He's like that. Yeah, that helps.
That's right.
You edit that out.
Yeah, we'll just catch, we'll tape over that. We'll tape that over.
Oh, see, for sure.
Don't
want
to fight.
Yeah.
Boom. Good.
Yeah.
There you go.
See the movement now? How you're keeping them off balance?
Yeah.
That's the key to lock flow, right?
The flow.
Yeah. Flow. Key. It's not lock. It's lock flow. It's flowing between techniques.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to fight.
Step back, Tim. You're doing the other lock. You did the other lock, Tim.
I did the other one. Back. I started with the first and got crossed up.
Yep.
He switched hands. Tried to go left hand.
Yeah. I know. I saw what happened.
See both in the...
Step to the outside and distract.
Boom.
Wrist lock. Now take your right foot and step your right foot backward. There. Now uppercut. Check the pulse and uppercut. Pull it out.
Yeah,
uppercut. There you go.
Yeah.
Good. You guys got it?
That was on the money. I felt that in my arm.
Yeah, you'll find it. You get it. You're like, oh, that sucks.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right? So, last lock two. Here's lock three. I don't want to fight. All right, again, I can soften this up any way I want. It doesn't matter. Right? Set the first lock, however you want. Boom. Distract again. Spike, elbows, whatever you want. Check the pulse. Step back, pulling to the hyperextension. Boom. Golgi, boom, he's on his toes. Now this is the part a lot of people have trouble with. You've got to do a bong style switch. Rotate and turn it over. And it's just that easy.
Yeah.
Once you get this, again, what have I said a dozen times? The transitions are more important than the locks, right, Tom? So I don't want to fight. Bang. Yeah, we've met, right? Wrist out, bang. Hyperextension. There's his balance. See, I don't even care that he went down. All I care is I got his balance. Boom. Hyperextension. Now.
That motorcycle rev right there.
Yeah,
I'm
starting the motorcycle because I'm on his palm. I can turn his wrist. So when I release it, what does his wrist want to do?
Turn
back over. Well, that's what I want. I want his wrist to turn back over so that his elbow comes up. So I'm turning this. Now I let my hands come down, wipe down. I come over the top of Golgi. I step out 45 degrees in front of his shoulder and keep his hand 45 degrees above his head. We say 45 and 45.
Mm-hmm. That's the key to getting
the drop. That's the key. If I don't, somebody Matt's size, if I'm here, Matt can probably pick my legs up and scoop me. Right, I'm gonna go. Right, if I'm here, even if I'm up, he can push his elbow into me, grab, see? But if I'm here,
it's like it's so close but so far away. Yeah. We're trying to.
Yeah.
Yep.
Very much so.
Yeah.
I'm gonna fight.
I'll believe you.
Good. Okay. One. Again, it doesn't matter which wrist lock you use. Two. Uppercut. Armbar. Rotate. Golgi. Now when I'm here, what do? I step forward and keep his hand there. Okay, right? Mm-hmm. Right? Well, you notice the Golgi here, guys. Right? If I get here and go,
yep.
See how he respects me?
Mm-hmm.
I don't have to push down. A lot of guys push down here. What happens is he turns this elbow, and now he eats me. Right? I want to keep my posture as centered and as vertical as I can so that I'm coming down. I'm not pushing down like this. Mm-hmm. I'm squatting down.
And that saw is your next distraction.
Yeah, and this is a distraction. Are you distracted, Tony?
I am, actually, yes.
Now, Tony may want to roll out of this, but that's okay. That's the next lock. Okay? Okay? He may transition. He may fight you and move, but that's what lock flow is for. Right? You put me in the arm bar. Right? He comes down, he drives this. I go forward and I roll out of it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, he should step around my head and start doing a different lock or put me in a handcuff position or any variation thereof, right?
Just go drop to the arm bar on the ground. If
that's the point of lock flow, to transition between the moves, right? All right, try the wiper. Mm-hmm. Reverse the arm bar.
Okay.
Boom. Check the pulse.
Oh yeah, check pulse.
Pull it out.
Barn door that leg.
Uppercut.
Keep it that right. Hip. Get that hand down to your hip. There you go. Now you can pick it up on the toes.
Alright.
See how I'm going? Cut over the Golgi. And get the bone. Get your bone on his Golgi tendon.
This. There.
45 and 45. Hand 45 above his head. Bring his hand 45.
There it is.
Yes, you can.
I don't
want to fight.
Liar. Didn't sound like it. Go slow, guys. Don't break anything. Nope. What'd you do?
No.
You tried turning his wrist instead of turning it on.
Mm-hmm.
Elbow.
So it's
Start over.
Mm-hmm.
Start over. Feel the transition. This is probably the hardest part for a lot of people. Now, yeah. There. Oh. Now, so you're trying to push on. Let his hand turn. Let his hand turn and cut over it.
Yeah. We're getting sticky.
Yeah? Yeah. You will. So. That's why doing it this way is important.
Gotcha. So when I bone saw over. Yeah.
Cut the bone. Cut the bone. 45-45. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. I can't move fast enough to keep up. Again, it doesn't matter what variation of the arm bar you do here. As long as you're transitioning, the lock is not as important. Go slow. Go slow. See, they're so off balance. You're trying to turn his arm instead of letting it twist.
Yeah, when I let go, I don't know if it's that I'm not torquing
help
it enough.
Help it turn.
Okay, so if I'm here.
What do I want to do?
Gotcha. Yeah. Feel free to tap on your leg if I'm going too hard. Or,
oh yeah, that's too good.
Okay, so from here, then.
Don't let go. You can't let go. It's just a turn.
It's just, we're sweaty.
I know. We're definitely sticking together.
And that's good. That's good. Uh-huh. It makes you transition more.
Uh-huh. My hand is still out. So here, good. I can goose there.
That's
to
another
line. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Check the pulse. Pull it out. Uppercut. Arm bar roll.
Arm bar.
45-45. Good. Yep, that's the next lock. Very good, man. Ty.
You okay?
You guys got it?
Yeah, it pop, my shoulders pop. It freaks Dave out all the time.
He likes making me mad. I'm
pretty flexy in my shoulders. Okay. Wrists, not so much.
So Tony grabs me because he's a bully, right? And I'm like, hey, please don't hurt me. Sucker. Right? I mean, I can be right here, bang. That's Kajukenbo, right? Mm-hmm. As soon as he grabs me, bang. You touch me, I touch you back. This is Missouri. That means it's legal. Mm-hmm. He touches me, that's assault. Now, I have to have a proportional response, right? I can't put him in the hospital 8 ways from Sunday because he grabbed my shirt. But when he does touch my shirt, I can touch him back.
Let him know that's a nice shirt.
Yeah. My buddy made this shirt.
You don't
want to
be grateful
that. Okay, right?
Close.
That's called a what? This is a percussive palm, right?
Mm-hmm.
Percussive palm.
Percussive palm, right? We have
bongo.
Yeah, how I go to ears.
Yeah,
help.
He'll bust your ears.
Yeah.
Right, I don't want to fight. Boom, this shot's this shot. That's a strike. This shot should be enough. If I go here, bang, right? Boom, vertical punch straight down the line. Bill G straight to the X. Boom. Or, you know, a lot of people teach, and let's go off the reservation for just a second. A lot of people teach a variation of this, right? Because they say, well, if you hit this at the right angle, right, what you're going to do is break the nose and the bone's going to go in the brain and kill. No, that's a lie. It's a myth. It's not true. It's a lie. That happened one time in recorded history because the boxer in question already had a broken nose.
Yeah.
And already had a piece of bone floating in there, mm-hmm. right? This, when I do this, not only am I endangering my hand from hepatitis or whatever he might have, mm-hmm. but this by definition sends him backwards. Mm-hmm. So now he attacks me and I've got to fight this, uh-huh. right? That's not effective. If you're gonna go to some kind of lion palm strike to the nose, this is useless. This is friendly.
That's what I was going to say.
He didn't like that.
No.
I can tell.
I do this, and it's like you're a putz. Mm-hmm. I do this, and it's like
you didn't like that.
Right? And that's just pushing. I'm just gently pushing with my palm.
Part of it is,
if I went smash.
Yeah, just you can get your weight away faster this way than you can. Well, and your neck bends this way.
Yeah.
It doesn't bend very far. Down and back. It's
right.
It compresses.
So if you're
going
to do
the
these kind of
air.
Shots to the nose, mm-hmm. you go down, mm-hmm. right? Brachial in here. Mm-hmm. It's right in here. You go here, hand a fist, whatever mm-hmm. you want, this shot. Right into the old pulse.
And to take a page out of your book, keeping your knuckles clean.
Right. Now the popo sees me hit Adam in the mouth here. Mm-hmm. Right? Notice all my over stuff is actually open hand, empty hand. Right? If I hit him, get my hands all marked up, mm-hmm. the popo comes on the scene, they're going to notice that I'm bruised up and bloody on mm-hmm. my hands. And they're going to decide probably that I was a willing combatant, a willing participant in this brawl, right? Mm-hmm. If I go, Like, he smacked me. There's not a mark on my hands.
True.
He's got a fingerprint.
He's got
a paw print, but he's got a like, look. Right? So, you know, empty hand is preferable. And if you're going to do these kind of nose strikes, they're useless. You know, this is about the only one that's actually correct.
Mm-hmm.
All right, but the point, it doesn't matter how I hit here, right? We're doing this. We're just palming to the crown of the head. When we say the crown, it's just at the hairline for an average person, right? That's how, because that's a hard spot, so I can hit him there, and it makes his eyes blink a little bit, but it doesn't drop. He might get a little bit slipping.
Mm-hmm.
But if I can hit this, that means I'm in plenty of range to hit that.
It is very
plenty of range to hit this. Right. Right. If I hit you with this, with any kind of force whatsoever, it's going
to
ring you. And that's all I need, right?
Yeah,
I don't want
to
fight. Bang. Boom. Boom. Right? Whatever I want to use here, it doesn't matter. Your system, your techniques. Come back. Boom. Check the pulse. Bullet. Uppercut. Bang. Notice the position. My palm's turning his arm. Uppercut. Now, my fingers loosen so his hand turns. And when it does, I turn his arm over. I come up 45-45. Now, if he comes up and taps or drops to a knee, I help him back up. So we can finish the flow, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when he's down here, I want him on his knees a little bit, but I don't want him falling. Now, all I'm going to do is go down. Notice my thumb comes off the wrist to my fingers. And I come down and through, grabbing my wrist, turning my hip away, my head away, so he can't elbow me in the face, right? Now, I pivot. My forearm, my elbow is at his bicep-tricep joint. I push down and elbow.
Down, though.
Right. Oh, yeah. If I come in here and try to push my arm around, he's going to eat me. Right? When I go here, that disorients him. Now notice the shot. When I'm here, boom. This is actually another distraction. That's a nice elbow to the facial structure.
It'd be more than a distraction.
It should get his respect. All right, Matthew.
Or in the conflict hall.
I don't want to fight. Please don't hurt me.
Destroy the girl.
The one.
So we're out. Bang. Bang. Rotate. Bang. Now, 45-45. I feel him come down. I kind of help him up so he can continue the flow. I can distract in there if I need to. Thumb comes through. I'm going to come down and around, grabbing my wrist. And when I do, I'm going to turn his hand in so I can rotate my elbow up to set it in position while I turn to facing. Pushing down and rotating. That should be a nice elbow to the jaw.
Mm-hmm. Now to be specific, when you say pushing down, you're setting that elbow on
my
top
elbow,
of his elbow.
Yes. My elbow
and driving down from that
is here. Keep your base mat.
Push down.
See that?
Yeah.
What you say?
Better be the elbow.
That's what I'm doing.
Yep.
I'm dropping his shoulder. People try to push this through like this. See how my arm's out of position? See
you
where my elbow is?
You don't have the leverage.
So now I start to push this. He locks that out and punches me in the face or knees me or something. Right? Mm-hmm. Instead, I come here. I set this here.
Oh, yeah.
Then you
you can't fight
you
that.
You take the position away
from
him.
You're trying to stop
your shoulder
from breaking.
Yeah, and it's the elbows. Yeah, there's a lot of nerves right there.
Yeah,
it's smart,
too.
There's at least three.
At least.
Right?
Yeah.
So he grabs. Bang, 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 right? Doesn't matter. Notice now, boom, I went straight in. Notice how I skipped through half the series to get to here? Why?
Because this is...
Because it's lock flow. Because
right.
I can, right?
Yeah.
I don't care. But I'm here. Right, when I get this, my elbow has to sit.
In between tricep, bicep.
There. Mm-hmm. Right? Just here. See how his elbow kind of drops into his shoulder? Then I, while I'm coming down, I rotate the other elbow up and across. Now, when I'm here, I'm going to set this for practice right up. Yeah. I'm going to set this for practice right above my clavicle, right on my shoulder, on the same side here. Right?
It's a nice tight lock.
Because I should be able to now gently, very, very gently, do a shotgun. Which means I take his fingers and bring his pinky to his wrist from here. Right? There's a dozen ways to do this lock. It doesn't matter. I can come through here and compress it, compress here. It doesn't matter. The point is I'm getting a kind of reverse gooseneck here with this shoulder pin. Okay? Boom. Boom. See? And just switch right to it.
Yep.
Bang. Here's the position. Down. See? Now help him up. I'm a helper. Bang. Elbow to the face. Shoulder. Okay. Very gentle, guys. Okay. Now then again, there's a half a dozen ways I can do this. I can do a telephone here.
Oh, yeah.
Right? It doesn't matter what lock you
do. It's kind of like a bicep slicer.
Yeah. I can do any variation.
Or a calf crush on the ground.
Okay. Yeah. And my hands out. Principle. Right? All I'm doing is compressing that together. Right now, I can lock this. It doesn't matter what lock you get.
The whole time.
Your balance
line is off. You just sweep my feet out.
Yeah, your balance is high line, so you're pivoting.
We're just pushing.
There's only so many directions that the joints are supposed to go.
So by moving smoothly, you start getting the transitional move, right? Okay, try it. Set it up, elbow to face. Gently. I've seen people knock stuff loose doing this. I saw one guy had a bloody nose out of it. One guy got a fat lip. We already had a chipped tooth.
Luckily, Tony knows a guy.
Tony knows a guy. Yeah. All right, go slow.
The gal, that's even better.
Is she cute?
Turn that off. Well done, sir. Well done.
Off the record.
Yeah, off the record.
I plead the fifth. I don't want to fight.
Go slow.
You see her push me?
Yep.
So you're just, you're not letting his arm roll, but that's okay. That's okay, we'll drill it. Now set it on your clavicle. Set it on your clavicle. There you go.
I do like that, that transition.
I'm going real slow.
There you go. Really feel.
Try to, get your free hand, keep it right by your leg.
That's why you want to feel.
That's how they're. Yeah, yeah. You start trying to tap dance it out. It's going to help you.
Right.
There's your transition, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I was just thinking. Right? Like how
there's your transition. But I'm fighting you, so you want to move to the neck.
Here.
Mm-hmm. Rotate it. 45-45. Float the arm bar. Go through. Figure four. Set your elbow in position. Drop down and roll up. See how that walks right into his face? Just crush it, however you want. Everybody got it? Now, again, Matt.
Matt could have this, right? I can move this in, boom, and I'm, sorry, buddy. And I'm sitting in here, some variation, right? And you're like, well, what can I do from here? Well, you can reap the leg, you can side sacrifice, you can do anything you want. Again, the lock is not important, per se. These are just sample locks for the basic lock flow in Kajukenbo. Literally, this is our beginning stuff, right? It doesn't matter what lock you do. What matters is that you transition and you take care of your business, right? But we're here. Matt grabs me because he's a grabber. Please don't hurt me. Right? Notice I set this. Right? To strike here pins this hand in the position, right? Maybe soften up a little bit. Set this again. Doesn't matter what variation you use. Right? Boom. Bang. Bang. Boom. Here we are, right? Mm-hmm. Bang. Now, next lock. Call this a wishbone. Imagine it's Thanksgiving. Switch my hands, turn his head away, and I pull, gently pull this, make a wish. Pull his hand here while pushing his head there. Obviously, don't do this hard or fast, or you'll run out of training partners.
Much like any of them.
Most like most of all the rest of it, right?
No.
Tim grabs me, I'm like, please. Right? See, all of this will probably end the fight. Right? Bang. Boom. See his balance? Bang. Rotate. Bang. Bang. See, I just keep moving. Bang. Now, again, I got the goose, right? I set this. Kind of brachial stun. I set my forearm across his neck.
Oh, God. This doesn't look right.
Yeah. According to my doctor, this is bad for you.
Right.
Go very gentle with this. This breaks a lot faster than you think. Mm-hmm. This is called the wishbone.
After you destroy their arm and shoulder like that, you can send them to Tony.
Tony will take care of it.
Tony,
take a look at what I'm doing wrong here with the arm bar.
I'm pretty sure the chiropractor for that kind of injury.
I don't want to fight.
Who? Right. Boom. Good. Okay. Now, stop.
Right.
So you're already off. You're already off.
Okay.
Sit here. Mm-hmm. Press that down. Turn it down.
Okay.
Keep turning it.
Mm-hmm.
Now hyperextend it. Okay. Now relax. Not hard.
Okay.
Now just let your fingers loosen. See how his hand turns?
Okay.
Do it again.
Yeah, I think I was rotating the arm.
You're trying to turn.
Yeah.
Now release his fingers and let it roll. And when you do that, roll it more with your arm. Boom.
Okay.
45-45.
Gotcha. Okay. Yeah, I think I was revving.
This is easily one of the hardest transitions.
Because uh-huh.
people don't understand this lap sal move.
Yeah. No.
Feel uncomfortable.
Oh, yeah. It doesn't take a lot at all.
And if I did a regular hand switch and
lower his
gauge. Yeah, that wouldn't.
Yeah, as tight as this.
Yeah, that'd be very.
That's recovery. It's, you keep your arm, but it's just like. It's not like you can resist.
It's like getting pulled apart like chicken.
Down mm-hmm. that real quick because.
Right. Yep.
You get.
Just, you can just hear a rip.
I don't know what you're talking about. I don't hear anything. I'm behind the camera.
Yeah. Opposite. I don't want to fight.